Welcome back to episode 6 of the Sources Say podcast, a brand new addition to the growing KSR podcast network. I am your host, Jack Pilgrim of Kentucky Sports Radio, and I am happy to be joined once again by two of the best up-and-coming recruiting insiders in the game, Jake Weingarten of StockRisers.com and Travis Graf of Cats Illustrated. How are you guys doing today?
Exhausted. I just worked out.
How'd that go to you? Were you getting buckets at the gym, or were you lifting?
We was doing lifting today. That's what I'm on today. I'm going to hoop at 9 tonight, but I'm exhausted. It's been a week since I lifted or really done anything in the gym. So,
which one are you worse at, lifting or basketball?
Just know if worse means amazing, then both.
How are you, Travis?
Doing good, man. Got another intel-filled episode. So
we've been talking a little bit this week, kind of bouncing ideas back and forth with each other, and when we do have a little bit of something to bring to the table this week, so we are definitely happy to be back again. Thank you guys for joining me once again. Last week we broke down the brand new commitments of Lance Ware and Terrence Clark, who they are as players, what their decisions mean for Kentucky, all that good stuff, and then we talked about Jalen Green and Kentucky parting ways, the other guard options, some of the visits the UK coaches have been making over the last week or so. If you missed any of that stuff, you can find our podcast by searching Sources Say or the Sources Say podcast on iTunes or Spotify. And while you're at it, go ahead and hit that subscribe button, leave us a 5-star review, and we would most certainly appreciate that. Today we will be breaking down Devin Askew's upcoming decision in October, including the news that he's going to be taking an official visit next week to Kentucky. Some new insight that I got personally on Jonathan Kuminga, Kentucky parting ways with Josh Christopher, whether or not Kareem Maine is a realistic target for Kentucky, news on J.J. Traynor, new visits, all that fun stuff. We are going to go ahead and start with Askew because, you know, this is kind of the prominent news of the day. You know, he's going to be making his decision in October. Kentucky was actually out west to see him in California for the second time in 2 weeks yesterday. And then today, Askew's father actually told KSR that he has scheduled his visit to, or that he has canceled his visit to Villanova and has instead scheduled an official to UK from October 4th to the 6th. Corey Evans of Rivals.com was the very first to break that news, but that people have been talking about it all day long. He also took an official to Louisville on September 1st, scheduled trips to Arizona for this Friday, then another unofficial to Memphis right before going to Lexington on August 3rd for the school's Midnight Madness. Because this is it's the most prominent news from an immediate standpoint with this decision coming next month, I want both of your all's takes on where you think he's going, you know, first and foremost. That's the most important part. And just kind of your take on his decision-making process, kind of where his recruitment started, how it's developed, and where you guys think it is now. So, Travis, if you want to start, we'll go there.
Well, first of all, I want to say that I think there was some serious Louisville buzz there for a little bit. But I think mostly whenever it comes down to it, I think you'll see that was a smokescreen in the end. I think he ends up at Kentucky, and I think he absolutely loved Louisville. I saw him on his Louisville visit. He was having a great time, but nobody's going to have a bad time visiting Louisville. It's the best college city in the country, arguably. In my opinion, I think it's number one. But I think this is all smokescreen. I think it's going to end up at Kentucky, and I think some people took the bait thinking it was Louisville. But
when do you think personally that the win – because, I mean – I don't think you can completely discount Louisville and what they've done. I mean, you got to give a tremendous amount of respect for Chris Mack and how hard they've been working. But when did you kind of sense that tide was starting to shift toward Kentucky's way?
Well, I thought it was Kentucky for a while, and then there was like a heavy wave of Louisville buzz. That gave me some pause on that. And once I kind of weeded through some things and had some conversations, I've come to the conclusion that my final picks can be Kentucky. And – That's what I'm gonna stick with. I don't care what any national guys say.
Now Jake, on the other hand, has been, you know, he's kind of gotten a different look on this whole thing. He's talked to Devin personally. He's been around Devin during his visit to Louisville. He got to see firsthand how much Devin enjoyed his official visit to Louisville and how much he likes the school and all of that stuff. He's been pretty adamant for a long time that he's Louisville bound. He put in a future cast on rivals.com for Louisville. Has your stance changed at all?
Nope.
And nope. Why not?
Once again, you said it best. I don't think it's a smokescreen. They've been recruiting him for nearly 2 years, and the fact that they've Coach Mack has stayed in consistent contact with him is also very impressive. And I think one thing we hear that, you know, Kentucky can't really offer him is that he'll be the guy. I think with UK compared to Louisville, UK is going to land obviously more than one five-star. And, like, the chances of Louisville doing that is not the same as Kentucky. So what you can offer him is he'll literally, if he commits here, he's going to be the face of the school and face of the program. And the fact that he has that shot, plus him loving the visit, and from what I've heard, he's built a good relationship with the majority of the guys that are on the team, and that would be here next year or so forth. Next year, as in if he reclassifies, which he says he won't. But
can we all agree that I think he's gonna reclassify?
So
what's your opinion on that?
Oh, so do I.
Yeah, I think
he wants to play a Peach Jam.
I think that's a big point as well, because I think, you know, we've seen players nonstop over the last just 2-3 years. We saw Marvin Bagley, who was just absolutely adamant, said, there's no way in hell I am going to reclassify. Stop asking me. It's not going to happen. And then the second Peach Jam happened, he said, just kidding, I'm going to reclassify. Yeah. And then this past year, it was Nafali Dante, and, you know, just so on and so forth. It happens nonstop. Why do you get the sense that he's going to reclassify? Where did, you know?
He's ready.
How so?
You could just tell. You said it yourself. And when I seen him, I know it was just an open run, but him going against these college players, one, he was 5 minutes late, and he just walked on the court and completely, not, I wouldn't say dominated, but he just looks so comfortable. And the fact that he gets on the court and one of the first things he does is defend Sam Williamson in the post. I mean, he looks ready. And I know it's just an open run, but I think he's ready. So it would be beneficial for him and whatever college program.
I definitely think he's ready, too. There's not very many elite point guards in this class. He would arguably be he's going to be top three at least, but he could make a run at the top point guard outside of Cade Cunningham. But my counter argument to what you said about Louisville, I think he would look much better with running the point guard, running the show in Lexington compared to Louisville with the wing options he's going to have to pass the ball. He's not going to have to score like he's going to have to at Louisville, because I think Williamson and Ward are going to leave after this year. It's a heavy burden to be a – I think he's good, but I don't think he's good enough to lead an ACC team deep in a tournament run, being the number one option on offense.
Yeah, and the thing is, he is a
– UK would hide a lot of his weaknesses.
He is the perfect steady force on any team. He's the kind of guy – I mean, that's why he fits so well alongside Jalen Green with Team Why Not, and Amari Burnett, Taren Frank. I mean, that Team Why Not squad was so good because Devin Askew was the constant, stable force leading that backcourt. He is not too flashy. He's not, you know, overly athletic. He's not going to dunk on anybody, but he is just such a pure, stable, consistent game. He's a knockdown shooter. I mean, the dude shot like 40. I mean, you hear all the horror stories of guys that somehow shoot 40-something percent in high school and then end up shooting 18% at in EYBL and Peach Jam, and everybody goes, "How in the, you know, what's the difference there? How come he's such a good shooter in the high school setting, but, you know, AAU? This guy, I mean, he's an elite shooter at the high school level and at the AAU level, and at a school like Kentucky, when you have a Terrence Clark and you have a BJ Boston and the other options that they're trying to add, imagine Terrence Clark taking the ball over at the wing and teams having to collapse on him, driving to the paint, and then leaving Devin Askew wide open on the perimeter. That's kind of where I'm starting to it's just all kind of making sense why Devin's so in love with the idea of playing at Kentucky.
I think, like I said, I think he absolutely loves Louisville and the idea of Louisville. I think at the end of the day, he knows what's the best business decision. And in my opinion, it might differ from Jake's opinion. In my opinion, I think that business decision is – Kentucky.
Well, what you bring up a really good point with that, because he did that interview with Chris and Peek of Rivals.com, phenomenal interview, and they she kind of went through school by school and said, okay, what is it you like about this school? What is it like you like about this school? And he brought up Louisville and said, family atmosphere. I had so much fun.
I saw him and Coach Mack just dying of laughter on the sidelines at the football game and, like, touchy. And, like, he looked comfortable with Coach Mack whenever they were together. And
I'll say this. If Mack doesn't land this recruit, he's still going to be a problem now that he has an elite platform. He's going to be a problem on the recruiting trail for everybody nationally. I think he's a couple years removed from having, like, a top two or three class.
Yeah.
And give credit to their assistants also. I've heard from recruits that the assistant coaches at Louisville are some of the coolest coaches.
How do you pronounce that one's name? Pegues? Starts with a G.
Oh, Gaudio?
Yeah, Gaudio.
Dino Gaudio, yeah.
I've heard recruits love him.
Yeah, so. I heard recruits love Coach Murray. And I've heard that from a lot of people.
Yeah. You know, kind of ending this you know, the Devin Askew talk. That Chris and Peek interview was pretty revealing to me because he was very high on Louisville from a fun perspective. He was like, man, I had such a blast. You know, there were 1,000, you know, 1,000 people at that open gym. You know, I can't even imagine what it'd be like at the Yum Center for a real game. But then when he started talking about Kentucky, there was a sense of kind of a business-like standpoint where he said, yeah, you know, Louisville was fun. I enjoyed my experience there, but my goal is to get to the NBA. John Calipari knows what he's doing. He you know, you can go there and be a 1-2-3 year player. You've seen guys like Tyler Ulis. You've seen guys like, guys that go in not as surefire one and dones, may not even end up being one and done, and they still have successful NBA careers. There was just a little, like, you know, a little twinkle in his eye whenever he was talking about Kentucky, and I thought that was pretty revealing. And not long after that was when the Kentucky buzz started getting pretty loud. And you know, I again, you got to give Louisville credit for how much they've done with him and all that, but I think at the end of the day it'll come down to a business decision, and when he makes that business decision here in October, it will be to Kentucky. And other interesting guard news that kind of goes hand in hand with this Devin Askew news is the fact that Kentucky parted ways with 2020 five-star prospect Josh Christopher this past week. And Travis, you started to get a pretty strong feel about this recruitment over the last several weeks. What do you know about how this unfolded, and what does it mean for Kentucky at guard moving forward, factoring in the Devin Askew news?
See, I talked to his dad last Monday, I believe it was, on the phone for about 30 minutes. And he was absolutely raving about Kentucky. He was talking about how Josh is built for Kentucky, Kentucky's built for Josh, how he can fit in at Kentucky, how he could be a rock star on that platform, and how he always plays his best on a big platform like that. So I definitely think that this wasn't the Christopher's decision. I think it was solely Kentucky's. And I think it comes down to they wanted Josh if he was a package with Jalen, and now that they got Terrence, they don't think that Josh and Terrence can work together.
Yeah.
That's what it seems like.
Yeah, and you bring up an interesting point with the timing of it all with the Jalen Green situation, because Kentucky cut ties. Well, it was a mutual, quote-unquote, decision to break up with Jalen Green. But the timing, that happened the week before, and then a week later. So the conversation that you had with Josh's dad happened after Jalen Green and Kentucky had their breakup.
Yeah.
So this was not these decisions did not go hand in hand. You know, as much as they're kind of seen as this package deal and all that, I know for certain that Jalen Green was incredibly, incredibly high, you know, high on Kentucky. His camp was incredibly high in Kentucky. They were not very happy with how things ended with Kentucky. They wanted them to be on the list, and they would have strongly considered them if they had stayed on the list for the whole time. And judging by what you said about your conversation with Josh's dad, it was the same situation, that this was initiated by Kentucky. It's kind of a shame because, and I know Kentucky fans are very high on Josh Christopher and what he brings to the table and all that. But at the end of the day, you're not gonna say no to two players like Jalen and Josh if you don't feel confident enough elsewhere. And that's kind of where this Devin Askew news falls in for me. moving on to Jonathan Kuminga.
Also could be related to the
cutting
ties.
Which that's very big news. Number one prospect in the class of 2021. Kentucky has now visited him twice over the span of the last 8 days. You know, we talked last week about how odd the timing of this move was, you know, along with Cade Cunningham. John Calipari had his speech where he said that we're not just going to be a hat on the table anymore. And literally less than a week later, he visits Cade Cunningham first, who has been seen as an Oklahoma State lock for a long time. I know there's UNC buzz lately and all that, but Kentucky had not been one of the seen as one of the main options for several months now. And then Jonathan Kuminga, where you ask pretty much any insider and everybody kind of just assumes that Duke's the leader with him. So with the timing of all this, I just kind of, you know, I went down the rabbit hole last week, breaking down all the connections between Calipari and Kuminga. And I just kind of wanted to, look at it from Calipari's eyes. You know, why are you going all in on this kid if it seems like a done deal that he's going to Duke? And then I talked about this last week that Lance Ware played on the same AAU team. There's the New Jersey connection with Calipari, you know, recruiting countless guys from that area, more specifically the Patrick School. I mean, MKG, Dakari Johnson, and who else was a Patrick School kid? MKG, Dakari, and whoever it was.
I'm drawing a blank.
There are three of them. There are three guys that came from the Patrick School.
Briscoe went to Roselle, didn't he?
Yeah, right. Yeah. But even still, to that point, there are seven or eight guys that have signed with Kentucky over the last several years since Calipari has been here from the New Jersey area. Then you factor in the Terrence Clark being the fact that he's very good friends with Kuminga. They talked about building a super team in college at Peach Jam. They mentioned it during EYBL. So, you know, ever since this news broke that Calipari was visiting the first time, when Kenny Payne went up to visit the Patrick School again, I just kind of wanted to call around and just kind of figure out what's going on, see this through Calipari's eyes and filter through the Duke talk, the reclass talk, all of that. And after several conversations with guys in the Northeast, guys close to his high school, couple different voices to try to, like I said, filter all this out. I learned something very interesting about Jonathan Kuminga, in that this Duke talk is they're actually a little frustrated about how everybody just assumes that he is a Duke lean, not even a lock. Like that, they're feeling that he's so wide open that he could commit to any of the schools on his list. He doesn't have an official list, but he is very wide open. He likes, you know, Texas Tech is an option because he has some family ties there. Yes, his Kentucky has a lot of ties. There are a lot of schools that are interested in him. He wants to give everybody on his list a fair shot. He is completely wide open, and they don't like the talk that Duke is the runaway favorite and that they're going to be
St. John's even involved.
St. John's is definitely involved, but you know, some other Northeast schools. The fact of the matter is that a decision for him isn't coming until winter at the earliest, likely spring. You know, there's a lot of reclassification talk. I think that it's, you know, in his kind of inner circles that it's expected at this point, but it's not a done deal. He has a couple academic hurdles that he has to clear, but there is some optimism on his end that they can get it done. So say he does reclassify, he's still 3-4 months away from making a decision at the very earliest. He could be a spring commit. You know, I kind of brought up the idea of, you know, the Kuminga and Clark talk, and somebody reached out to me and said, you know, there's no way they would end up on the same team for branding purposes. You know, those are both two guys that are trying to be the number one pick. You know, they're not going to put themselves in a position where they could both hurt each other's draft stock because of how close they are. And I think that's just, I think that's garbage, to be totally honest. I mean, didn't Duke just do that this past year with RJ Hampton or RJ Barrett and Zion and then Cam Reddish as
Cam
well?
Cam Reddish was the third. He was ranked third going into college in the whole country.
Yeah, weren't they 1, 2, 3?
No, I think
Zion fell to like five.
Yeah, Zion fell to like four or five.
I think at one point they were all considered one, two, three. Yeah. Regardless, it was considered the
top three.
Reddish didn't get as much buzz as he did in high school. And I think that's what happens when – I mean, these super team things are cool, but it could affect draft stock, and it's not a good
thing. Well, and that's kind of – so when I was reaching out and asking people about it, I was like, how much is this guy – he's obviously aware that he's the number one player in the country, that he could start for an elite college team right now and be an instant impact type guy. And I kind of just brought up that idea of, okay, he talked about being a super team. Is Calipari doing all of this, kind of setting up this, okay, say Devin Askew at the one, or in an ideal world, Cade Cunningham at the one, Terrence Clark at the two, B.J. Boston at the three, is Jonathan Kuminga type of guy that would step in at the four and join something like that? And I've heard that he is a type of guy that would be more than okay sharing the ball with those guys. They said, you know, one of the most underrated aspects of his game is that he does so much off ball. He is not a ball dominant guy. He can go, you know, if Terrence Clark wants to take the game over, he can go get an offensive board, or he can grab the defensive rebound. He can make an impact on the defensive side of the ball with, you know, grab a steal, grab a clutch block. Like, he's one of those guys that just wants to be an instant impact player no matter how he does. It doesn't have to be he scored 53 points in a game against Cade Cunningham during AAUs. But he's also a guy that could, you know, grab 20 rebounds in a game. He's just one of those guys that can do everything all over the floor. There is a lot of confidence that around his people that they don't care who's there, because they know how good he is. They know what he brings to the table. Why would the number one player in the country, you know, with all due respect to B.J. Boston or even Terrence Clark, why would Jonathan Kuminga be scared about what B.J. Boston brings to the table?
Would you rather have Kuminga, Clark, and Askew over guys that are already in 2020? Well, Clark's in 2020, but how many guys are they going to take?
So Kuminga and Askew over guys in 2020?
How many?
Well, I think they're the most realistic option. I mean, of course, I think you go with, well, I mean, Cade and Kuminga is kind of a wash to me.
My thing is, if you get Kuminga, who cares? Like, who – I mean, to be totally honest.
We could run that team.
Come on. You get Devin Askew, who we talked earlier, who is just a stable force. He is the kind of guy that thrives with those type of players, who you get a Kuminga who can take a game over whenever he wants, a Terrence Clark who can take a game over, B.J. Boston can score at will. You get a Devin Askew where you know, the all your wings, they collapse in the middle and leave Devin Askew wide open. He's a 45% three-point shooter. I mean, that – it to me, on my end, watching Calipari from afar, it definitely looks like this is how he's trying to set this thing up. He's trying to get commitments from Devin Askew next month, get him reclassified to 2020, make it official so that can be his pitch moving forward. He can have Devin, Terrence, and B.J. Boston locked up as your 1-2-3, and then say, Kuminga, here's your, you know, this can be your team now. You are the one missing piece on this team. And then at the five, shoot, who cares? I mean,
Cade goes to UNC.
Sure. And I would
– You'd rather have Kuminga than Cade?
Absolutely. Times out of ten.
You would.
And you guys know how much I like Cade Cunningham. Cade Cunningham is the best guard in the class. I mean, by far. But you're never going to convince me that Jonathan Kuminga would not – I mean, that is the superstar player that Calipari has been looking for. Terrence Clark can be that type of player. He's a top consensus top five guy, but Kuminga is the number one pick no matter where he goes. I am that high on his game.
And he's still really raw too, and he
just started playing a couple years ago, and he's already putting up 53 points against Cade Cunningham in EYBLs. Like, he is that guy that can just score a million points. He can grab a million rebounds. He can block a million shots. He's just one of those guys. He's 6'8", 215 pounds, strong as an ox. He's one of those just plug-and-play guys. You put him anywhere, his people believe that he can thrive in any system, any setting. And, yes, Kentucky is one of those systems that he would thrive under. And people around him are not pushing him to Duke. They're not pushing him in any specific direction. That's part of where the frustrations kind of came from, is that they want this kid to make a decision based on him and him only, where he thinks he's the best fit. Could that end up being Duke at the end of the day? Absolutely. This is not me on a soapbox saying he's a lock for Kentucky and all that stuff. I just want people to be.
I want to know what's the difference between the New York Wrens coordinator, coach, or whatever, went to Duke, graduated Duke,
right,
from Duke, won a championship. Everybody's conceding Kuminga to Duke because of that mainly, but they had Hamidou Diallo and Lance Ware. They're both are going or went to Kentucky, so where's the
and
disconnect?
Hamidou Diallo had offers from Duke and Kentucky when he made that decision. So, yes, that is an excellent point. This is – he could very well end up at Duke. He could very well end up at Texas Tech. I think he is more leaning toward joining a super team like that and kind of taking the college basketball world over, win a national championship in his 1 year, and then get the heck to the NBA. I do think that he is that way, but he at least wants – his say in the matter. He doesn't want people around him making the decision for him. He doesn't want people to assume he's going to Duke just because there are some Duke ties there. But John Calipari, as we talked about with Cade Cunningham, as we talked about with some of these other guys, Terrence Clark, whenever that kind of fell into their lap, when that opportunity presented itself, Calipari said, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and just try to lock up the number one player and all of high school basketball. And shoot, he dominated against Imani Bates during UIBL this past year too. I think Calipari is very, very serious about this Kuminga talk. I would not count out Kentucky at all. I would probably put it neck and neck, put Kentucky neck and neck with Duke right now, if I were being totally honest.
And he could definitely still end up at Duke, but I think I agree with you in the sense that it's more open than people.
He just needs to be able to take his visits. He needs to be able to experience his recruiting process without people in his ear telling him where he's going. And
he's,
that's
we won't
not, and that's not happening
either, will we?
Right.
He's the number one guy wherever he goes.
Doesn't matter. Yeah. If you were the number one player in the country with his type of skills, would you care who
there's
was in
no,
front of him?
There's no point of him staying in 2021.
He's already dominant. Yeah.
He's already dominated. He doesn't need his recruitment to – he doesn't need anything else, for real.
That's the hardest thing.
Unless he wants to win Peach.
And that's fine. He can still reclassify to 2020 and still win the Peach Jam if he wants to. But nonetheless, we'll get off on that. Well,
the hardest thing that I'm having right now is with this 2021 class, trying to weed through what's BS and what's not, about who's going to end up reclassifying, who's not.
2021 is the most reclassified reclass talk I've ever seen.
Because 2020 is going to be a juggernaut at this
point. I've ever seen, yeah.
Because you're going to have, like, the 20th best player that would have been top 10 a couple years ago at this point.
Yeah, it's crazy weeding all that stuff out. Have you guys, you know, I know I went on a rant about Kuminga for a while. Have you guys been hearing anything on Kuminga or
a lot of Kentucky talk? The fact that they had staff see him twice was a big deal. And we'll touch upon that with Jaden Hardy. I think that's a big deal. That shows their target, especially like we've been saying, the staff is not going to go see somebody unless they think they have a chance. We touch on that every week, so.
Did you mention Nick Richards is the other Patrick Squirrel?
That is
Patrick
that. Squirrel. Thank God. Patrick Squirrel. Thank God. Yeah. Patrick School. Nick Richards is the guy.
Calipari's got a bunch of deep ties up there. Mm-hmm. Regardless who the Wrens AAU guys affiliated with, but like you all said, Calipari's not gonna go up there just beating around the bush if he thinks he doesn't have a serious chance.
And you know when he's going up there, he's taking all these pictures with the young kids, and you know he's kind of doing,
you know,
the
who
big,
do that?
Big celebrity Coach K.
Yeah.
But yes, I am very high on Kentucky being a contender, not as the favorite or anything like that, but I do like Kentucky's chances in the Kuminga battle. Now we will move on to the Jaden Hardy news, the fact that A, Kentucky offered him, and B, that Kentucky's gone to see him twice over the last 2 weeks. Jake, I want you to kind of take over this segment because you've been all over this one. The very first, you were kind of the first one to break the news over the last several weeks that he got the offer, that Kentucky's been visiting, all that stuff. Tell us what you know about Hardy as a player and his recruitment.
I think that he's the number one combo guard in the country for a reason, and I do think, like you said with Askew, I do think he's ready to reclassify, but Kentucky will have an assistant. And again tonight, and then Cal saw him, I think it was last Friday, right?
Something like that.
It was definitely last week, but he's very talented. I mean, his brother's at UNLV, but they're not a serious contender for him. He's had that offer for so long. Arizona State thinks they have a chance. So
mm-hmm. Okay.
His recruitment's kind of all over the place. I expect him to take a visit. With reclassification with him, I do think he's ready. He is the number one combo guard in the country, and I think it all depends what happens with Kentucky in 2020.
So. See, my thing is, I talked to his coach last week, and he was adamant. He's like, "Yeah, we're not going to reclassify. There's really no benefit for us to do so." And I could see that if it's from a Kentucky aspect, because I don't think he would start over the guys that are committed right now.
If he wants to go to UK, he'll stay in 2021.
But
unless he believes he could get that spot.
Do you think Kentucky's his leader at this point? Or up there? Do you think?
Oh, they're definitely up there. He definitely was excited when he got that offer. But, I mean, the fact that they've been in twice already obviously shows something's going on there.
Well, at this point, he could be the number one player in 2021 with all the reclasses.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, shoot, he could be the, you know, what is he, 7 in 2021 right now?
Well,
I think
he's definitely top 7 on
top,
all
I've
outs.
Seen him from like 6 to 8.
He is a consensus top 7, top 8 type player. And
his coach calls him the best shooter in high school. He scored 37 against Modern Day and Devin Askew.
He's a walking bucket.
So on that note, Jake, what you've kind of followed his, you know, him as a player and his recruitment a little bit. What do you know about him as a player, and whatever school he goes to, what will they be getting as a player?
A walking bucket. He's going to take over any offense at any school he lands at. I think that if he does not opt to not go to Kentucky, then I think he would be a great fit at Arizona State. I think that's a very big guard school, and I think he would literally take over there and be one and done.
See, I don't want him to go there because I want to be able to watch him play. You don't get to watch them play.
Yeah.
Yeah, he'll be – he would
– I'm not staying up till 1 o'clock in the morning to watch a tip-off against UTEP.
On another note similar to, you know, in the guard scene, 2020 five-star guard Kareem Main. Nobody really has any clue what the heck's going on with this guy. You know, I know ESPN released their latest mock draft for 2020, and he was included. I think he was, 25 overall, 26 overall, mm-hmm. in this latest thing. So he's draft eligible next draft. But there's a lot of talk that he's hell-bent on going to college and enrolling in a school and experiencing the college experience for at least 1 year. What do you, you know, I know, Travis, I know you got in contact with his AAU coach recently. What do you know about him and whether or not Kentucky's even recruiting this kid, whether he has an offer or not? You know, it's kind of all over the place. Try to lay out the scene for us.
All right, I think there's a lot of gray area and a lot of questions still unanswered with his recruitment and where he stands. His coach told me that, like you said, he's hell-bent on going to college, that they've already made that decision. I mean, could they go back on that? Of course. I asked him if UK had an offer. And he said, I didn't even ask him. He said UK offered this past summer after the games in Greece. And then so I said, oh, UK offered? And he said, yeah. But he may have misspoke, but I re-asked the question. So he said, yeah, so I went with it. But then there's a lot of questions on if he has an offer from him himself and other people around him. But he's really raw as a player still. He's big guard. He's like 6'5", probably 200 pounds, 190 at least. And he's an okay shooter, really athletic, but he's kind of maxed out. He's a little bit old for his age, I believe.
Yeah.
So he's kind of maxed out where he's at physically in college and draft evaluations.
I think he's league-bound, but to discuss the Kentucky interest, I'll call it interest because he hasn't mentioned an offer.
Yeah, you talked to him personally,
yeah,
didn't you?
Yeah, I talked to him personally, and they've been following since July when they were up at Greece. That was in June, July, right? Mm-hmm,
yep.
Just around then. And basically, they asked his AAU coach and his coaches for film, and they got film. And he said that they were in contact, but there was never an offer. And I reached out to him 2 or 3 days ago, and I said to him, what's new with Kentucky? And he's like, the same that it's been, and left it at that. And the same that it's been as in what we've been talking about, which is film, and they've been in touch, whatever. But Maryland and Georgetown are on him the hardest right now. Maryland was – Turgeon went to see him when he played overseas and was the first one there. And then his only official visit was to Maryland in June. So,
and a reminder that Canada Elite, his AAU team, is Under Armour, and Maryland's Under Armour. And his coach said that he hasn't talked to Maine in a few weeks. I think he's – been doing other things, so who knows. I'm going to try to text him again.
I think he's league-bound regardless. I mean, the feedback that everyone's hearing on him NBA-wise, it's hard to turn down. And you said his age. I mean, might be best for him to go to the NBA. If he does go to college, I think he'll end up at Maryland.
If you're a first-round pick, go get that guaranteed money.
Facts.
Yeah, I mean, this very first mock draft, he's 25, 26. If he, and, you know, in these upcoming camps and, you know, however he – I don't know what he's going to do over the next several months, you know, in terms of a national exposure perspective. I'm sure his team will be involved in some pretty prominent recruiting events and all that stuff. So, I mean, you could see his stock boost to – you know, top 15, you know, that type of level. And if he gets into that lottery range, there's no way he's going to turn that down. Even no matter how much he wants to go to college, there's no way you turn that down.
It's definitely not a deep class for all those there late first rounders that could play themselves up higher. Because being older, if he goes to college and is mediocre average point guard, he's just another year older next year. And next year's draft looks a lot deeper than this year. So I bet he ends up going pro.
Moving on to 2021 top three wing, Patrick Baldwin. He also received a visit from Kentucky this week, earned an offer from Kentucky back in August. He's a 6'8", you know, super silky smooth scorer. What do you guys like about his game? And I know, Travis, you've been digging into his recruitment as well. What are you hearing on that front? What do you start with his game and then go with his recruitment?
Well, I think a good comparison for him is a Kevin Knox type of player that is a better shooter and has a much higher ceiling than Kevin. Pretty silky smooth, like you said, shoot the lights out. But
pretty effortless, right?
Yeah. He looks like that. Looks like he's not even trying out there. Really, really smooth with the ball and without the ball. The on the recruiting front, though, I've reached out to people around him without much response. I'm going to keep digging with that. But there has been some Kentucky buzz, if you have not heard it.
Yeah, I mean, so to kind of give background on that, he's been not necessarily a Duke lock, because I mean, a lot of his picks on his 24/7 Sports crystal ball they're pretty old, but he's 100% listed to Duke right now. But one thing, the Kentucky buzz has kind of gone hand in hand lately with the news that his AAU program, Phenom University, recently partnered with former Kentucky wing Tyler Hero, actually, and they're now called Phenom University Team Hero moving forward. So Kentucky, Kentucky is involved with that from a branding and sponsorship standpoint because of Tyler Hero himself. I've heard that Tyler is very vocal within that that AAU program now. He's talking to their AAU coach and he's kind of trying to give back to the kids right away, trying to, you know, kind of give them a good role model. He's a lottery pick in the NBA, looking like a very promising rookie prospect. Trying to create that, you know, good role model for, you know, immediate role model that they can, you know, if you follow these in my footsteps, not necessarily to Kentucky, but just in general, you could be a lottery pick one day like me. I've heard he's been very influential in that program, and that's kind of gone hand in hand with this Patrick Baldwin news. I know he's also teammates. Phenom University also has Jalen Johnson, who is a Duke kid. He committed to Duke this past summer. There's a little bit of reclass talk with Baldwin, which that could go hand in hand with going to Duke with Jalen Johnson, or, you know, if Kentucky doesn't end up getting Kuminga, they could end up making a strong push for Patrick Baldwin in a reclass situation. Are you guys hearing any reclass buzz with him?
I'm hearing reclass buzz with everybody in the top 25.
Well, I know we just talked about that. It just seems like everybody in the nation is wanting to reclass.
I haven't heard anything concrete for me to really say, so I'm going to try to figure out more before.
I think he'll end up reclassifying going to Duke.
So, are they even going to have anybody left in the class of 2021? Or actually, you know what's going to happen? All the 2022 kids are going to end up reclassifying to 2021, and this whole process is going to restart next year. We'll move forward with the kind of recent news that North Carolina. They picked up a big commitment from Walker Kessler this weekend. He took an official visit to the school, and that gave them 2 5-star centers in the class of 2020 with De'Ron Sharp already committed. Armando Bacot was a 5-star McDonald's All-American last year. But he's not seen as a one-and-done type guy. Garrison Brooks was a four-star power forward back in 2017. He'll be a senior this coming year. So that'll potentially be 3 5-star centers and 1 4-star power forward on the roster. So the question I have for you guys, with this commitment of Walker Kessler, what does it mean for UNC's recruitments of Isaiah Todd and Greg Brown?
I'll first touch upon, I think it impacts De'Ron Sharp more than any of these guys, because I think that De'Ron Sharp's at Montverde now, and obviously Cade being a target, I think that De'Ron, I'm not saying De'Ron wouldn't want to play with Walker Kessler. I think he'd rather be paired with Cade than Caleb Love. And then I think Zaire Williams is a name I've heard a lot.
And with that, on that note, Caleb Love is set to make a decision. He's one of the top guards in the nation. He's set to make a decision next week. Rumblings growing louder and louder that he'll end up at North Carolina. So you got to factor that in as well with the Cade Cunningham news. So, building on your point and kind of asking you, what does Caleb Love's decision likely to commit to North Carolina mean for De'Ron Sharp, Cade Cunningham, kind of the whole scene?
I think that has a major impact on Cade. I think that if Caleb ends up at UNC, then Cade will go elsewhere, because obviously Caleb's a 5-star guard. He's not going to ride the bench, So I think that if you get Caleb, Cade will end up elsewhere. It's my opinion.
My thought process on this is if they're set to take a commitment from Caleb Love, they don't feel good about Cade Cunningham, and if North Carolina doesn't feel good about Cade Cunningham, I doubt Kentucky does. So I'm interested to see if Kentucky visits Cade Cunningham anymore, because I think at this point, I think he ends up back at Oklahoma State.
But he also is taking his official visit to North Carolina this weekend. So the fact that that's still on and he's all over Instagram and all over social media talking about it and kind of saying, what's good, Chapel Hill? You guys excited for me? All that stuff.
There's a lot of hype surrounding Zaire Williams, De'Ron Sharp, and Cade Cunningham. That's what UNC fans want. I'm not saying they wouldn't take Caleb Love with Walker Kessler and who else, but I mean, if you want to put Isaiah Todd in the mix, I think if Walker Kessler and De'Ron Sharp are there, where's Isaiah Todd going to go?
Overseas.
Right. Well, that's kind of the talk of.
My thing is, you can get a Walker Kessler type anytime you want. I don't know where all the North Carolina stuff came from, because he was a Duke lock a week ago.
That was pretty awesome.
He was a North Carolina lock like 5 months ago, and then it switched to Duke. It kept changing.
But if you're set to get somebody like Isaiah Todd, possibly because they're the perceived collegiate leader for him right now, or possibly Greg Brown, I don't know why you take Walker Kessler and muck that up
and potentially ruin their chances for two inarguably better guys. I mean, there's no debate that Isaiah Todd and Greg Brown are better players than Walker Kessler, which does bring up a good point about Isaiah Todd going overseas. It's kind of interesting that
that's what I was.
This past spring, there was reclass talk really, really heavy. In fact, those close to him thought that he was making the jump. Like they were feeling pretty confident that they were going to make the jump. He ended up not. I think his mom ended up making the final call with him. His mom is a very loud, very prominent voice in his recruitment. She, he obviously loves and uses her as a mentor with all of this stuff. So she ended up helping make that call when it was all Kentucky. If he had reclassified to 2019, it was all Kentucky back then. Then this summer, the Kentucky buzz was still there, but then the overseas buzz started kind of trickling in a little bit. Fast forward a month or so, then the overseas talk is now extremely loud. And the North Carolina buzz was still factored in. But yeah, all in all, the overseas talk is definitely the prominent noise right now. But with Greg Brown, it seems like that Kentucky buzz is growing louder and louder with him, that there are kind of genuine worries with him that Shaka Smart won't be there next year.
That's what I heard.
That Texas Tech is going to have a mediocre year this year, and that if and when that happens, that he's leaning Kentucky.
I think that if you're wanting an elite power forward, I think that's definitely your best bet, because, like I said, I think Isaiah ends up overseas or North Carolina somehow. But yeah, Shaka Smart, he's up to his neck in hot water. So I think Kentucky's sitting pretty. I think he's deciding in the spring, ain't he?
Yes. Yep. 100%.
So I think that's set up perfect. I think Kentucky's getting all these guys in early. I think they get Askew next month, and then you go all in for him in the spring and Kuminga.
The how this could all unfold is they already got BJ Boston and Terrence Clark. You get Devin Askew to run the one. You say, screw it, let's go all in on Jonathan Kuminga, see if we can get him at the four, and then go to Greg Brown at the very end of the day and just say, dude, they're going to be attacking all of our wings, you know, at the rim, leaving you wide open for lobs. If you're not wide open for a lob, Devin Askew is going to be wide open in the corner for an open three. Like, that lineup is one of the most deadly you could even possibly dream of. So I mean, if I'm Greg Brown and I'm deciding between my comfort level with Texas and Shaka Smart and a guy that might not even be there in the spring, versus what could be there at Kentucky, you know, with that potential death lineup. And even if Kuminga doesn't end up in Kentucky, say go all in with Patrick Baldwin and have him be as another shooting threat on the outside with Devin Askew combined with BJ Boston and Terrence Clark is you know,
other. If I'm Kentucky, I show North Carolina a picture of Nasir Little and a picture of Shaka Smart not doing anything and be like, all right, look, you can come here and be the Bam Adebayo of this team. Just be the athletic big that does nothing. But he's not as bulky as Bam, but plays the same type of super athletic.
Mm-hmm.
What was Bam drafted, 13?
Yep, lottery. Yep.
Lottery, and he shot maybe five, six times a game. And yeah, four of those were dunks.
Yeah, I mean, it's all aligning very, very well. There's, you know, you can take some pieces out and add new pieces in. Things could shift just ever so slightly. But all in all, at the very end of the day, like Kentucky, they are feeling pretty freaking confident about how this is all unfolding. Not necessarily Greg Brown, but I mean Greg Brown on top of everybody else. They're feeling pretty confident about how this is all unfolding.
When was the last year that UK had as good of a class, like in the reins, in the early signing period?
Never.
Had three.
They've had four signings in 2012, I believe, and I think that was when they had Anthony Davis, MKG, Kyle Wiltshire, and Marcus Teague. That was the last time that they've had four. And what happened in 2012? They won a championship.
They're going to have a top five player this year, two top 15 players in Askew, in my opinion, and BJ Boston. Then you're going to have a fringe five star in Lance
Ware. And then solid returners too, right?
And then Cam Fletcher. And then if you return Keon Brooks.
At that point, you return anybody on that team, and
I'll admit that's scary.
It's scary.
I think with all these guys, though, that Kentucky feels good about, I think Kentucky's the best platform for them. That's one thing with Greg Brown. I know staying at home at Texas is very intriguing, but I think if he goes to Kentucky, he's a lock for the lottery.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. We're going to end this show once again with Bardstown's own JJ Trainer. For a guy that's a four-star prospect, man, he is dominating the airwaves and all the internet, you know, websites and articles and stuff like that. I mean, this is a guy that is booming. Just news just keeps coming out about this kid. So Travis,
I got some scoop on him.
Good, even better.
He just had Virginia Tech and Cincinnati stop at his workout. You guys probably
Virginia Tech loves him.
Yeah.
Cincinnati does too.
Travis, go all in on what's the latest with JJ Trainer.
All right, I talked to Boober, Bardstown's head coach. He said that I asked him who's going to offer first, Kentucky or Louisville. He told me yesterday Kentucky. He said as of right now he thinks Kentucky offers first. He said Kenny Payne was absolutely blown away with his upside, with his jump shot. They're not worried about his weight. They said you can put on weight whenever you get to college. They were talking about his crazy wingspan, how he can guard threes and fours and some fives. He's 6'8 with a 7'2 wingspan. They said you can't teach that. And they're just in love with his upside and his hard work and skill set.
And apparently Kenny Payne called John Calipari during the middle of the workout and said, dude, you got to come in and see this kid.
Yep.
And sparking, you know, when Kenny Payne comes to visit a kid, it means something. When Kenny Payne feels a need to call John Calipari and say, you have to come see this kid. And when John Calipari comes to see a kid, it's serious. Mm-hmm. That's when you know that an offer could be on the horizon. I actually heard from people kind of in the Kentucky AAU circles who they think that he is going to be an early signing, which doesn't necessarily bode well for Kentucky because they, well, you know.
But if.
So this but, could this could spark Kentucky he said to.
He said Coach Cal is supposed to come back. He said very soon. So he told me that this past weekend or this past Friday, I believe. So it could be this week, it could be next week, who knows. But it's right up the road for him, so.
Yeah, definitely. And somebody else told me that they think that so Xavier offered Trainer last week as well, and because of the Chris Mack Xavier connection there, that Louisville was going to be very, very soon they're going to step in line and offer as well.
I've heard about that.
So the fact that I've heard that Louisville could be quick to pull the trigger on an offer, but Kentucky's might be even quicker to pull the trigger on an offer.
One would surprise me, really.
It might work out in Kentucky's favor that he makes a decision this fall.
Louisville had, I think it was two or three coaches at one of Trainer's workouts. You guys would know that better than me, but I heard it was a 6:30 a.m. workout,
yep.
And they were blown away.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I heard.
Every school that's went to see him has come away really impressed. I think a lot of schools are just want to see him in game action.
And that's
the only in-game action he's really dominated so far in his basketball career is the AAU stuff this past summer. So
that'll happen this November, right?
Yep.
And signing period is in November, so it'll be a tight squeeze if they want to get a commitment done in the fall period. But I mean, if you're a Trainer in Kentucky and Louisville say, hey, give us 2 weeks until when the basketball season starts before you make your decision, you're not going to tell them no in favor of WKU, right? I mean. You're going to listen to Kentucky and Louisville and say, okay, well, if an offer's on the table here in the next couple
Western's
weeks.
Western's crown jewel for this class.
Right, and that's kind of where the early talk came from because everybody just assumed, okay, well, WKU's in love with him. Rick Stansbury is just going all in on this kid because they know how good he could end up being. So it's kind of a race for them against Kentucky and Louisville to try to lock this kid up in the coming weeks. Versus giving Kentucky and Louisville just a little bit of time to make this happen, where they could be in contention for a commitment. So before we with that, we'll end it there. We'll wrap it up. Why don't you guys tell everyone how to find you on social media and where they can find your work?
StockRisers.com, and once again, I apologize. CardinalSports.com, amazing site, amazing site.
What about on Twitter?
At Jake Weingarten.
With the verified check, by the way, for you. Not so much for me. I'm on Twitter at Trav_Graf. You can find my work at Cats Illustrated on the Rivals Network. And I also have another podcast that covers all UK stuff and national sporting news. It's called the Cat with a K Scan Podcast.
And with that, we will be back next week for another jam-packed Sources Say podcast. We will see you then.